That on American television.
Can you tell me if you have seen that clip before, Mr. Biljian?
Yes, I have.
Can you speak of it?
It is one of the most tragic events that that has taken place in South Africa. Of course, it's not the only one of its kind.
Can you tell us the circumstances of this particular event?
This particular woman, it was in at a place called Duduza that happened. She was merely one of the group. As far as I recall, it was at the occasion of one of these funerals that has degenerated into a political demonstration of some sort, where one person out of the crowd identified her as a collaborator with the police, accused her of passing information out of the black community to the police, and she was summarily executed without any, process of law, without even having the opportunity to state their own position.
Did anyone come forward and state the truth of her position following this death?
A group of four or five people are facing charges. If I'm not wrong, the court is expected to give its decision within the next few days, within the next weeks. It is really, on the point of being finalized, and it is expected that, very severe punishment will be meted out to a group of about five young people who took the lead in this necklace murder. Well, it wasn't strictly a necklace murder, but in this execution.
Mr. Kendricks, I have traveled to Ghana and Liberia. I have lectured there. I have met with the heads of state there prior to their execution. And in my travels there, I warned them of this capitalist communist conspiracy on their nations, accepting help from the IMF, getting in the fangs of both sides of the issue. I was present as I delivered a lecture before the president of Liberia, where there were communists in his armed forces, and they were supposedly the soldiers in the room in a church where I was speaking. He was ripe for takeover and for assassination. I told him so. I told the other leaders. Time and time again, we see Africans running their governments, winning elections, and then the losing team coming forward and murdering the winners. Or we see then military takeovers and other people in the military then murdering them, and so it goes. Is there any end to blacks killing blacks in these rivalries? Are blacks in South Africa ready for full self-government? Or will we always see the necklacing of radicals, by radicals, of moderates? Can they take on the government that they desire to participate in, even in their homelands?
Well, I think that for South Africa, the blacks have Black people have evidenced a very strong and lasting role of leadership. I mean, blacks have been in control and running Ciskei, Transkei, Botswana, Venda, for the whole period, for years. Much longer than the white South African government has at any one point in time set as the leaders of the government there. I mean, they've gone through Verwoerd and God, all the way back, four or five leaders now, while blacks have been there. I mean, they've been running their affairs. They've been strong leaders. They've been dynamic, both at church levels, political levels, medical levels, industrial and entrepreneurial levels for the last so many hundred years. So I don't see that that's a major issue. I think the point in time now, the point where we are today, is how to bring about a new South Africa, one that works for the whole and all of the people of South Africa. And while I can't sit here in the United States and say I have the solution, I can clearly say to you that there are people of all ethnic groups in South Africa who have the professional and intellectual capability of sitting down at the negotiating table to work out the political dispensations that are needed to go forward into the 1990s.
We see a threat here. Do you fix it on the ANC and communist fomenting among these youth that somehow arouses them to be capable of this kind of murder?
What I saw was terrorism, murder, and control in a manner that would slow the process toward a reasonable negotiation around a table of peers, basically intimidation. I don't think that kind of violence will deter people who want freedom. And I don't believe that kind of violence will give people freedom. I do believe that act that we just witnessed was perhaps the most heinous act that I have ever witnessed in my life. And that people of goodwill on either side of the political spectrum would not use such tactics in the name of freedom.
But necklacing is happening today, and it continues. It's communist inspired and instigated, and some people, some blacks in South Africa, have decided it's the only way to gain freedom for South Africa.
Those are people who want reasonable South Africans of all cultural and ethnic divisions to capitulate. And I don't think that's going to happen, because I don't believe freedom-loving people of South Africa will allow themselves to be controlled by that kind of violence. Not the people that I have met there. And I don't believe the majority of the people support that kind of violence. And as a consequence, I do believe that the reasonable people of South Africa will come together to fashion a solution that will allow them to move forward. No matter how many communists there are, I don't believe that will be the outcome, and that kind of violence will beget capitulation of the South African people.
Do you believe that they are sufficiently aroused to just how deadly and insidious a communist movement can be and has been nation after nation? Do you think that they are rallied and aroused against this necklacing as they should be?
The only analogy that I can give you that comes close is to suggest to you that those people in South Africa are as aroused as we are in America when we find a dope dealer in our neighborhood. We don't like a dope dealer in our neighborhood no more than you do. And I don't think they will stand for murderers in their neighborhood no more than we would. And as a consequence, they will eradicate that kind of behavior. And that kind of behavior has dissipated since the imposition of the emergency rules in South Africa. They are not going to tolerate that kind of lawlessness, nor are they going to capitulate on their constitutional duty to protect human life and property. It just isn't going to happen.
I recently read an excerpt from a speech given by Oliver Tambo, where he cautioned the comrades of the party to be more discreet in their use of the necklace because of the unfavorable public opinion that it was getting abroad. So I wonder how much that is a factor in the decline of that particular behavior. Also, I'd like to comment that I don't believe that people in America would tolerate that kind of behavior either. However, I have shown this clip to a good number of people, ministers and others, and I have had them say to me, looking at this scene, say to me, well, that's one or two or three blacks who've been necklaced in South Africa. That is a small group by comparison with the millions of blacks who have been systematically discriminated against in South Africa. That's what they have said. Also, I believe that there is a move afoot to re-educate Americans to accept this as a means of bringing about change in a government. I was recently in Los Angeles, and I think you were at this very meeting when Tambo spoke, and the woman delegate from L.A.
Maxine Waters,
said that the era of Martin Luther King Jr. had passed. She said, in effect, that we believed in those days in the power of nonviolence. But, she said, South Africa is a totally different situation, and they have to employ a different method there. And by that, I assume she meant violent revolution. And so I believe that there is a move afoot in this country to re-educate Americans to accept violence as a reasonable means to bring about social reform and change. There is also in this country an organization housed, I think the office is in Oakland, California, called the National People's Liberation Party. They are advocating now the same philosophy that the ANC is using in South Africa. They're saying, in effect, that the only way a black can achieve any measure of economic liberation in this country is that he be a collaborator with imperialist United States interests. And I have a document in my possession. It was an annual report to the Communist Party given in Moscow, where they say that black teachers, doctors, lawyers, any successful black in this country could not have attained that legitimately, and that what he or she deserves is the same treatment that we have just witnessed here. So I think that we have a serious problem on our hands. The ANC, for example, is this very moment establishing ANC, the American arm of the ANC, in many of the major cities across this country: Los Angeles, Washington, New York, Philadelphia, Miami, etc.
What is their goal?
Their goal is to organize young blacks into the ANC philosophy. They want, they've just begun a national and a major campaign, recruitment campaign. And part of the, I don't know if it was 55,000 or 30,000, whatever it was, that they raised in LA the night we were there, was supposed to go in part for the maintaining of the Los Angeles office. So what I'm saying is that South Africa, I believe, is in a way a training ground for what they expect to see take place in the United States. Now they take the long-term view, and I believe that what they're doing in part is conditioning the United States in a way to accept this kind of behavior, and heaven knows what. Also, you mentioned the fact that Bozak and Tutu had begun to back away from their militant stand on sanctions. Well, that's true, but they also play both sides of the road. Right now, Ronald Dellums is preparing to present to the Congress a bill that will place certain pressures on countries who refuse or who do not divest from South Africa. It's going to be a major thing by 1988. While at the same time, Walter Fauntleroy, delegate from Washington, is preparing legislation that would give increasing economic and even military support to Zimbabwe, Mozambique, and the other surrounding governments of South Africa. And so you see, they really don't care about what happens to black people in South Africa.
The Congressional Black Caucus, which is basically composed of black, all blacks, when you come right down to it, they're left-wing, they're radical, and when Tambo comes, he gets a royal treatment. When Buthelezi comes, he's totally ignored. And yet Buthelezi leads something like 6-7 million Zulus, and is really a reputable leader and has a good overall view about conditions, whereas Oliver Tambo is, you know, a Soviet flunky. So when you come right down to it, we're dealing with the fact that right now the United States has promised to those three frontline Marxist states, Mozambique, Angola, and Zimbabwe, $500 million. Now the promise has been made, and I think that's just the first in the pipeline, probably of billions of dollars, because George Shultz is now heading up the State Department. He's point man formerly for Bechtel. He represents financial interest in America, and he's the one behind USTEC, and he's definitely behind increased trade and aid to the Soviet Union. So when you come right down to it, we are now in the situation where our State Department is, again, doing what they've done in the past. Now, if you've got the Congressional Black Caucus touting that particular line, and you have the radicals in Congress also touting that line, Dellums' bill probably has a fairly good chance of passing.
Well, I know that the Soviet Union and its proxies are depending. I mean, you would not have had the sanctions movement or any of this if you did not have the pressure from black America on the Congress. The Congress, they don't want to be called racist, right? And so they'll do anything to avoid being called racist. I want to make it very clear, I don't understand how it is, understanding that the black church is still the very heart and soul of that community. I don't understand how black ministers can see a film like this, can accept necklacing as a means of negotiation or anything. I don't understand how they can follow Fauntleroy or Randall Robinson. There is nothing in the whole religious thought of this community that can allow this kind of thinking to manifest. I don't understand it.
Well, you have Jesse Jackson, who said he was going to start a moral crusade with Fidel Castro.
He did.
And you have him arm in arm with Daniel Ortega.
That's right.
And you have him buddy buddy with Louis Farrakhan, who is buddy buddy with Muammar Gaddafi, takes $5 million from him. So you begin to see all the network of connections. You become aware of the fact that when the Soviet World Peace Council comes to visit America, which has been bought and controlled by the Soviet Union since 1949, the World Peace Council comes to town. Who's the one that sponsors the reception for them? Ron Dellums, Gus Savage, John Conyers, Howard Welby, these individuals who are radical left-wingers in Congress and who keep the pressure up. So you become aware of the fact that Chandra Romesh, who heads up the World Peace Council, is an Indian communist, well known for years. So you become aware that there are forces moving in this country, very powerful forces, that have a lot behind them and are able to manipulate the press and the media in a very fantastic way. You take a look at the press that Jesse Jackson gets. Everywhere he goes, he gets press, good press. And yet you know he's a radical. You know he's a... I won't go into that.
What's your response to all this?
Amazement.
I was going to say it's very interesting to observe the way Americans speak about their own country.
That's all.
I'm not going to get into the presidential run-up to the presidential elections, or, you know, I think I desist. But yes, certainly we have noticed that the Reverend Jackson has made a point of, at a number of occasions, calling the very meager relationship that exists officially between, you know, on at official level, between the USA and South Africa.
He was the one that pushed on the South Africa in terms of the Olympics. He was one of the moving forces behind keeping you out. At the same time, he's willing to make a trip to Moscow, he and Tom Bradley in L.A., to try to persuade the Soviet Union to come to the Olympics in Los Angeles. Mm. And this country has got such a very short memory. It was 1941, 42 when Jackie Robinson broke into professional baseball in the major leagues. Black, remember? Long time ago. And so we sometimes expect this moral self-righteous viewpoint, which I feel many Americans have when they look toward South Africa, that we expect them to resolve all their problems overnight, when it took us 25 years to work through the civil rights crisis of the 60s.
1987, no black players on the baseball
team. We still, right. We got black basketball managers now. One,
coaches.
I think Sam Jones, yeah. But they don't own them, that's true.
Mm. I mean, you know, after Jackie, we should be able to own one.
You would think so.
You can loan us the money.
No, if I would.
Well, I'd like to give you the opportunity to make a very concluding statement, Mr. Viljoen, not on behalf of your government, but please, on behalf of all citizens of South Africa, speaking as a citizen rather than a member of the government, what would you like Americans to hear?
I would like Americans to know that we're determined to stand together, all of us, and we're determined to fight this out against foreign aggression, foreign intervention in South Africa, from wherever it comes. We are going to work out our own solutions to our own problems, and they will be equitable.
Mr. Viljoen, Mr. Kendricks, Reverend Vossler, and Reverend Fraser, thank you for being the flame of freedom that speaks at Summit University Forum.
Thank you.
I know there are many parts to this issue that our listeners and you, the audience, would have liked to have had addressed more thoroughly. I regret we do not have more time. We'd like to invite you back on the same subject, perhaps in 6 months, when we see what has transpired and how the events are unfolding. Thank you again. Our hearts are extended to all of you for participating in this forum.
Thank you.
On behalf of the people of South Africa and the United States of America and all free nations, I'd like to thank each and every one of you for your great support for freedom, nation by nation, for your attention this evening, and for the support I know that you're going to give, both in prayer and in action, on what you've heard this evening. I'd like to tell you then about this day's schedule, for it's a happy 4th of July to you already. I think in a moment we're going to be the first Americans in this time belt to sing our national anthem on the 4th of July. So I invite you now to sing our national anthem. Let's see the flag up. Anybody want to please carry the flag out? Be a sight for sore eyes right now to see Old Glory.
Smile. America, we love you. America, we love you. America, we love you. And our love is great enough to hold you eternally victorious in the light.
God bless you, everyone, and we are dismissed as we take our rest with America the Beautiful. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Information on this and other Summit University forums, as well as lectures on the defense of freedom by Elizabeth Clare Prophet, write Summit University Press, Box A, Livingston, Montana, 59047-1390.